And I would say without a doubt there's Mexican drug cartel activity in Iowa, yes.
80% of the drugs in Iowa come from Mexico's drug cartels.
This is all from one load.
They push drugs and violence into our communities.
Sheriff's office, search warrant!
This is with me every day.
So we went to Arizona to find out how the drugs get to Iowa.
The numbers are hard to comprehend. Thousands of people killed, tons of drugs seized, billions of dollars exchanging hands.
And Iowa is right in the middle of the cartel's distribution network. In part one of her series, Sonia Heitzhusen travels to Arizona to track those bringing drugs across the border.
Miller!
Yeah, these are very dangerous. These are all known cartel members, all part of the same cartel that we've been dealing with for years.
It's the middle of the night in Pinal County, Arizona.
In the magazine.
Just as he does on every mission, Lieutenant Matthew Thomas with the Pinal County Sheriff's Office makes a mental checklist.
You're getting your stuff ready. You're getting it to game time mode.
Who's going to be on the skids?
His team plans to raid two locations tonight.
If there's nobody out there, I'll wait till they start hitting the door.
They're stash houses used to store drugs awaiting distribution through a nationwide network.
Sheriff's office, search warrant!
Lieutenant Thomas and his team take the people at the stash house into custody. And uncover a truckload of drugs. There are more drugs in the stash house. Along with a shrine of saints. Some are legitimate saints, like the Virgin Mary. Others, like St. Jesus Malverde, are called narco saints. He is considered the patron saint of the illegal drug trade. Traffickers pray to Malverde for the safe delivery of their loads.
Just fly over that area, see if you pick anything up.
Lieutenant Thomas carries a picture of Malverde in his patrol car. It's a souvenir from his days undercover, when he had to convince the dealers he was one of their own.
Every time you walk out the door, you always wonder, is today the day, you know, and who do I want carrying my casket? What type of funeral do I want?
He's developed a warrior mentality. You understand why when he explains how the drug cartel has infiltrated the area.
They've got bad guys in their communities that dress like good guys, act like good guys, but indeed they're working for the opposition.
There are bad guys in the mountains and on the ground. The person in this tractor may only be posing as a ranch hand.
But that guy may indeed be employed by the cartel on the side and has a cell phone or has a radio, and as soon as I pass by, he recognizes me as law enforcement. He just makes a phone call in and says, hey, law enforcement is at this location, that location.
As we approach a known drop site, it becomes clear.
So if you guys just hold tight and then I'll let you know when we're all good.
They are watching us as much as we are watching them.
Like if you want to film anything, you can get out, but just stay at the car just in case.
After giving us the all clear, Lieutenant Thomas shows us evidence smugglers are using this old ranch house to transfer drugs.
There's been activity here at least in the last week for sure. Obviously the fire, because it's not damaged by rain or not that wind damage, so that's fairly recent, like within the last few days.
The smugglers are called mules. They walk day and night through the desert carrying as much as 50 pounds of pot, heroin, meth, or cocaine in homemade burlap backpacks.
For us, that's indicative of drug smuggling specifically.
One of the more interesting finds at this staging area are these little booties. They're made out of carpet. This one even has some Velcro on the back. They're used by the smugglers to camouflage their footprints.
When they reach the drop site, the mules drop everything, their drugs, their outer layers of clothing, their water bottles, and they wait for word from the next person in the drug cartel chain of command.
They'll clean up, they'll rest, they'll eat. They'll let their bosses know, hey, we're here at the pickup point. Then a vehicle will come in. They'll load the vehicle up.
Another vehicle will pick up the people.
Then they shoot them back south and they do it all over again.
Some mules, referred to as quitters, rely on law enforcement for a ride home. They'll walk to the nearest interstate or highway and simply surrender, knowing they'll be returned to Mexico. For some quitters, it's a short walk. This is a drop-off site directly below an Interstate 8 overpass.
They'll just follow the wash all the way up to I-8. They'll stage here. They'll make their phone calls. Hey, we're here.
As lookouts watch for the law, the drugs are loaded into a transport vehicle pulled off on the side of one of the busiest roads in Arizona.
said, they're like a pit crew. Within 5-10 seconds, they'll have that car loaded up with the dope, and that car will be on the interstate again and on its way.
The fingers of the Mexican drug cartels reach across the country. Before they even cross the border, the drugs are brokered out to dealers located in cities like Phoenix, San Diego, Denver, and Dallas. They then travel north and northeast along the nation's interstate system. I-80 and I-35 are two major pipelines leading directly to Iowa. Later in our series, tracking the drugs on our interstates.
Without getting too specific, because I just can't do that.
Oh, you can tell that they're going to different places based on the markings on the side of the packaging.
The impact on people near the border.
I'll shoot to kill and ask questions later.
So that's what we call in law enforcement a clue, that things aren't getting better.
And here at home.
Those groups impact Iowa tremendously.
Lieutenant Thomas says there is now drug cartel activity in nearly every state in the country. The violence stemming from it claims tens of thousands of lives in Mexico. And just recently, a woman in El Paso, Texas, was hit by a stray bullet from cartel across the border in Mexico.
Yeah, the violence has really been escalating. Back to the mules, are they actually employed by the cartels? I mean, seems so extreme what they're doing.
Some of them are actually employed by the cartel. The cartel also kidnaps people actually in Mexico or will threaten the mules. If you don't do this, we're going to kill your family. So it's more incentive for the mules to get their drugs to their destination.
And also a vehicle by which they make it into our country.
Exactly. That's some of the way the human trafficking takes place too.
All right. Part two tomorrow. Thanks, Sonia.
This is all from one load.
The amount of drugs crossing the border is mind-boggling.
It's not just marijuana, it's black tar heroin, it's methamphetamines, it's cocaine.
More than 750 tons seized in 2010 alone.
It is largely trafficked on foot, by land, and in vehicles.
Vehicles traveling our nation's interstate system from the Southwest to the Midwest.
The vast majority of the drugs that we see brought to Iowa do come by vehicle.
Iowa's interstate system is the ideal gateway for drugs.
It's another mode for the Mexican drug cartels to reach across the country and into our communities. Channel 13's Sonia Heitzhusen continues her investigation tonight. It's new at 10.
Stay up on this frequency if you guys need anything, give us a call.
Evidence of drug trafficking litters the Arizona desert.
194, go ahead.
Trails wind through the sand. Water bottles, clothing, even vehicles are abandoned after they've served their purpose. The gas cans in this pickup indicate it was used to refuel other vehicles in the smuggler's arsenal. The convoy of drugs seems never ending.
The DEA in Arizona, at one point, if it was under 500 pounds, they wouldn't prosecute it. So
Under 500?
Yeah, that's the amount of drugs that we have coming through here.
Lieutenant Matthew Thomas with the Pinal County Sheriff's Office says the terrain in this area makes it ideal for smuggling. The desert valley is surrounded by mountains which serve as lookout points for cartel members.
It's a daily event because obviously the more drugs the cartels can push through, the more money they get in return.
Money is the motivator. This is the catch from just one bust. 8,000 pounds of pot worth about $4 million in Pinal County. The street value can triple by the time it reaches the Midwest.
Just one branch of the Sinaloa drug cartel has brought over 60,000 pounds of marijuana each and every month through our county. It's a billions and billions of dollars of profit that these cartels make.
Pinal County Sheriff Paul Babu has run out of places to put the seized pot, heroin, cocaine, and meth. This area was designed to process vehicles for evidence. It's been turned into a storage area for drugs. It's about 6 feet deep, 4 feet wide, and 20 feet long, and it's packed with bricks of marijuana. Two more storage units are also loaded with drugs. It's saved until the people who brought it over the border are prosecuted.
We bring in so much of it, and we can't dispose of it and incinerate it fast enough.
Elias Johnson, the public information officer for the Pinal County Sheriff's Office, says the pot swept up off the floor alone is a sizable amount.
This is stuff that we just pick up off the ground because it gets so heavy that the sacks actually break up.
Most of the packages are marked with letters, numbers, words, or pictures. The markings are not random.
These are the codes used by the drug cartels to determine where these drugs will be going. They could be going anywhere, California, Colorado, even Iowa.
Phantasma to us means nothing, but to them, it tells them where it's supposed to go.
Without getting too specific, because I just can't do that.
Art Vogel is the resident agent in charge of the Drug Enforcement Administration's Des Moines operations. He's been with the DEA for more than 30 years.
On occasion, those markings, colors, etc., indicate who the original packager and sender was. On the other hand, they can also indicate, once they're across the border, what groups in the United States they may be destined for.
So each drug cartel might have its own little kind of stamp, so to speak?
Correct.
These are drugs seized in Iowa. Notice the markings similar to those on the bundle seized in Arizona.
Those groups impact Iowa tremendously. All of the drugs that we see coming to Iowa originate in the in Mexico and then work their way across the border.
The drugs work their way up to the Midwest via the country's interstate system. From Interstates 8 and 10 in Arizona to Interstates 35 and 80 in Iowa.
So just by the nature that I-35 and I-80 run through Iowa and intersect right here in Des Moines, does have a bearing on how many drugs we see here in Iowa.
The National Drug Intelligence Center analyzed data from 2008 through 2010 and revealed distinct patterns in the routes used to move cocaine, heroin, marijuana, and meth. The bigger arrows indicate the routes with the highest volume. The vast majority of drugs coming into Iowa go undetected.
It's a significant amount.
The DEA estimates it intercepts just 10 to 15% of the drugs traveling on the nation's interstate systems.
You're talking about the heartland of America. And you look at the corridors and the trafficking that comes into Iowa, and it can travel east and west through the main distribution points.
Stopping it starts here.
343. Unfriendly people out here.
But those on the front lines say it's a war.
And who's winning this war?
A war getting bloodier by the day.
I have a gun on my ankle right now, too. It's a Glock.
Wow. So, Aaron, imagine an Iowa farmer carrying a gun to protect himself from drug cartels. But that's exactly what's happening in Arizona, and you will hear more from that farmer tomorrow night at 10. And his fear is real. The number of people in Mexico who are being murdered and violently, it's in the tens of thousands. There are mass graves, people beheaded. The carnage is very real. It's hard to describe here in Iowa, but people are very scared there.
And rightly so. So it begs the question, if we know that the drugs are coming through Iowa, is the violence following?
Not directly, but there is a human toll here as well. There are trends showing that the drugs that are coming into Iowa are more potent, more deadly, and there is an indirect human toll. We're going to talk about that tomorrow night at 10.
Okay, we'll be here. Thanks, Sonia.
So you're darn right I'm concerned. This is real. It's how I live my life.
Some might call it extreme, but this Arizona farmer is packing heat to protect himself from the Mexican drug cartels. The violence at the hands of the cartels is well documented. Torture, mass murders, beheadings.
It's part of the territorial battle in Mexico, but now the death that surrounds the drug trade is spilling into the U.S. We want to caution you that some of the images you are about to see are very graphic. This is part three of Channel 13's Sonia Heitzhusen series, Iowa's Drug Gateway. It's new at 10.
All right, these are ICE guys right here. Okay, good, good.
Illicit drugs flow across the Mexican border day.
Pop one of those up in front, would you?
Oh, nice. Yeah.
And night.
Bravo, Delta, line up on the Bearcat.
The supply matches what seems to be an unending demand.
They're asking if we're ready.
Border Patrol, ICE agents, and local law enforcement are waging a war on the Mexican drug cartels.
And here in Arizona, we're on the front lines.
Many more are caught in the middle.
So it's criminals against criminals here in our state, and sometimes that ends up in shootouts and people getting killed right here in our county. We have had this happen countless times.
Within a five-mile radius of this farm, I know for a fact that there's been two people killed by the drug cartels.
Scott Blevins farms about 800 acres in Pinal County. He's lived here for nearly a decade. About 3 years ago, he says he noticed a change. The cartels, emboldened and driven by greed, started closing in on his land.
Where I had a drug load that was seized on our property. But to finally see it happen on the farm here, I just said, something's got to stop. We got to do something. So I started speaking up.
Blevins also started carrying this.
This is with me every day. It's a Glock.
He also wears a bulletproof vest and carries a rifle in the cab of his tractor.
This is my gun that I carry at night.
Blevins says he won't hesitate to use it.
If someone approaches me in the middle of the night, I will shoot. I'll shoot to kill and ask questions later.
Things aren't getting better. They actually have grown more violent.
From Mexico to the Midwest, the bodies are piling up. These are the direct victims of the drug cartels, tens of thousands of people killed in the battle to control the drug trade. Others are casualties of the cartel's commodity.
He was a huge part of my life. I talked to him every day.
Lisa Nauman remembers her big brother by placing a cross at the motel where he died.
Some reports say they were up all night partying, and I'm not sure when my brother passed out. Apparently at like 8 o'clock in the morning, he was unresponsive.
Chad Nauman laid on the motel room floor for nearly 12 hours before anyone called 911. By then, it was too late. The cause of death? A heroin overdose.
Yeah, we didn't expect it at all.
Lisa says her brother, known around town as the rock and roll carpenter, was an alcoholic and at times abused prescription drugs, but heroin wasn't on her radar.
I didn't realize that was a problem in Iowa. I mean, I knew that it was around, but I didn't realize the extent of it. And during my brother's investigation, the police had told me what's coming here from Mexico is like 85%. Pure, and what used to come is 50%.
The high-grade heroin Chad consumed is called black tar heroin. It's blamed for at least 24 overdoses in Iowa in the last 2 years.
We are definitely keeping an eye on that.
Add it to the list. Law enforcement admits it's hard to keep up with the cartels.
This begs for a national solution.
The money made off the drug trade is matched only by the amount spent to stop it.
Enforcement is only one piece of the puzzle.
Each bust is a small victory, but the question remains, are we winning the war on drugs?
We're not going to lose, because to lose, somebody has to give up, and we're not going to give up.
And we'd like to thank the Pinal County Sheriff's Office for the access it provided, as well as the use of some of their video. Nearly 50,000 people have now been killed because of the drug war in Mexico. Honduras has the highest homicide rate in the world. As a result, some Latin American leaders are calling for the decriminalization or the legalization of drugs, something Homeland Security Secretary Janet Napolitano and most law enforcement do oppose. But it's something that's being put out on the table right now, and it's a debate that will continue.
It sure will. Of course, Napolitano knows a lot about it, being the former governor of Arizona, very close to her. But the DEA, you've told me, is saying enforcement isn't enough. So what do agents propose?
Well, it really comes down to demand. And as Art Vogel said, you need law enforcement, you need enforcement. But in addition, he says you also need education to keep people from becoming addicted to the drugs, and then treatment for those who are addicted. One thing that Lisa Nauman is doing, the young woman you heard from in the story, she's starting a support group here in Des Moines for families and addicts of opiates.
She's been really vocal about what happened to her brother. All right, thanks, Sonia. Great series.
Thanks.